That's okay, you could have finished. I would have waited. This morning, we are going to install Nikos Kobal as a new altar boy. So at this time, we are going to bring him forward and bless him and make him holy so that he may serve at the holy altar. Mom, I like how the prayer says, that he may appear he may appear before your presence holy, undefiled, innocent, and thus be made worthy. So he may appear that way. So thank you.
Christ is risen from the dead, trampling down death by death, and to those in the tombs bestowing life. Christos voskrese, smeti smet, smet po pravi, sushim vorobi, shivo darovav. Christ is risen from the dead, trampling down death by death, and to those in the tombs bestowing life. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill among men. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill among men. O Lord, you shall open my lips, and my mouth will show forth your praise.
Christ
Blessed is the kingdom of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, always, now, and ever, and forever. Let us pray to the Lord. For the peace that comes from heaven above and for the salvation of our souls, let us pray to the Lord. For peace throughout the whole world, for the welfare of the holy churches of God, and for the union of them all, let us pray to the Lord. Fear of God, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our holy ecumenical patriarch Bartholomew, the Archbishop of Constantinople, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our God-loving Bishop Gregory, for our esteemed priesthood, for the diaconate in Christ, for all the clergy and people, let us pray to the Lord. For the honorable government of our country and all civil authorities and for our armed forces, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this city and for every city, village, and country, and for those who with faith dwell in them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For healthful seasons, for an abundance of the fruits of the earth, and for peaceful times, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who travel by land, by sea, and by air, for the sick, the suffering, and for those who are held in captivity, and for their safety and salvation, let us pray to the Lord. From all affliction, wrath, and want, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help us, save us, have mercy on us, and protect us, O God, by your grace.
Lord, have mercy.
Ever-eating or ever holy, ever pure, ever blessed and glorious Lady, the birth giver of God and ever Virgin Mary, together with all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and our whole life to Christ our God. For to you are due all glory, honor, and adoration, to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever and forever.
Amen.
Let God arise, and let his enemies be scattered, and let those who hate him flee from before his face. Vanishes, so let them vanish, as wax melts before the fire.
Thank you.
Be attentive. At that time, Joseph of Arimathea, a respected member of the council who was also himself looking for the kingdom of God, took courage and went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. And Pilate wondered if he were already dead, and summoning the centurion, he asked him whether Jesus was already dead. And when he learned from the centurion that he was dead, he granted the body to Joseph. And he bought a linen shroud, and taking him down, wrapped him in a linen shroud, and laid him in a tomb which had never been hewn, which had been hewn out of the rock, and he rolled a stone against the door of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, saw where he was laid. And when the Sabbath was past, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, bought spices so they might go and anoint him. And very early in the morning on the first day of the week, they came to the tomb at the rising of the sun. And they were saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the door of the tomb?" And looking up, they saw that the stone was rolled back. It was very large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, dressed in a white robe. And they were amazed, and he said to them, "Do not be amazed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. But go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him, as he told you." And they went out quickly and fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment had come upon them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Christos voskres. Christ is risen. Christos anesti. This morning, the third Sunday of Pascha, we commemorate those who cared for the body of our Lord after he was crucified, the myrrh-bearing women and Joseph of Arimathea. I very much like this gospel and the writings of the Holy Father, who asked the question, was the stone rolled back from the tomb to let Jesus Christ out? And they answer, no, it was not to let Jesus Christ out. He is God. He could walk through closed doors. It was rolled back to let people in to see that the tomb was empty, not to let Jesus out, but to let people in to see. In the Tropadion this morning, we sang, "The noble Joseph, having taken down your most pure body, wrapped it in a clean shroud and anointed it with fragrant spices and laid it in a new tomb." According to burial customs of the Jews, it is said that these myrrh-bearing women carried over 100 pounds of spices. They must have been female bodybuilders, so they're pretty strong. That's a lot of weight to be carrying pretty far. But it's quite interesting to learn about burial rites of different ancient civilizations around the world. Some Native American tribes would move their home or their tent to a new location after they buried a loved one. They were afraid that the ghost was going to come back out of the ground and haunt them, so they literally moved their home. Some of them would not even speak of those who had died. They were forgotten, never spoken of again. The ancient Greeks, before they became to believe in Jesus Christ, believed that the body was but a prison for the soul, and the body had no real value. Therefore, they were able to treat it any way they wanted. Any kind of immorality to the body, it didn't matter. It was no good anyway. It was to be discarded. The many pagan tribes burned the body in cremation, believing that they burned the body to release the soul to the heavens. Some would even set the body on a boat and send it out to sea and light it on fire as the boat was floating away. But the Hebrews, on the other hand, had a special relationship with the one true God. They always believed that they were created in the image and according to the likeness of God, and therefore the body was good. It was to be anointed, it was to be wrapped very carefully and buried in the ground awaiting resurrection. But this Jesus Christ was considered to be a criminal. Most of the times, those who were crucified, their bodies hung on the cross for many days, not just a few hours, but many days. And when they did die, they were thrown to the dogs or placed in common tombs, unmarked, certainly not to be cared for. So, who would spend money for an unmarked tomb? Who would spend money to bury a body that was considered unclean, disgraced, and dishonored? Now, many of us, we will do acts of kindness for someone who is living, and sometimes we do it out of selfishness because we're going to receive some kind of reward or gratitude for our acts of kindness. So how much more does it say about the man who cares for the dead, who cannot pay him back, at least not in this lifetime? And furthermore, who would have the courage to approach the Roman governor who at any time could have snapped his fingers and said, well, you're going to be crucified next, or I'll throw you into prison for asking for the body of Jesus, to ask for anyone who had been crucified? Yet this is exactly what Joseph of Arimathea did. He went with courage and asked for the body of Jesus. He loved Jesus Christ that much, he did not care what was going to happen to him. He had courage, he had strength. He had courage in the face of the enemy. Recently, at our priest convocation, our Bishop Gregory spoke about the acts of violence that are happening to Christians around the world. And it made me think of another clergy convocation that I went to, where Bishop Thomas gave a clergy retreat in Pittsburgh. And their message was the same. They said, prepare your flock. Prepare your flock for what is coming. They said, we are living in a post-Christian era. It is no longer a Christian society, and the enemy is at the gate. And I asked, prepare them for what? Do you know what the answer was? You ready for this? Prepare them for martyrdom. Prepare them for martyrdom. Now you may say to yourself, well, not here in Johnstown. That happens on the other side of the world. But I assure you, it can. It is reported that ISIS already has a large cell in Mexico, about 100 miles south of the U.S. border. Some modern Christian editorial writers say that we will see some kind of an attack on Christians in America within the next 5 years. I think they are being optimistic and conservative. It will probably happen in less time than that. And then what will we do? But ISIS is not the only threat to us. Christianity is under threat of our modern society. Our youth, our young people, many of them, not the ones here, but the ones that are out there. They look to the government and social media for moral teachings and listen to what the government says is moral, not the church, but the government. What the media says is proper or improper. And they threaten Christian institutions to comply or else what? Be taxed? Be thrown into prison? Be crucified? Be beheaded? One only knows. But we let it happen, when we are reaping the consequences of what we have sown in society. It is now a very common occurrence for children of a devout Orthodox Christian to simply cremate their parent without asking. or bury them from the funeral home because they don't want to be bothered. They don't want to pay the priest the stipend. They don't want to give a donation to the church. It's easier just to bury them from the funeral home. Let's get it off. Just move it out of the way. That's a very common thing. Thank God, not so much here in our cathedral, but it is happening across the diocese. It is a popular practice now to scatter the remains of our loved ones over their favorite destination as we have cremated them, or split them among families. Can you imagine that? Cremate a body and split it between the different siblings so that everybody can have a part of that body on the shelf. Where is that care for the body of Christ that we see Joseph of Arimathea and the myrrh-bearing women? Where did that go? We lack courage to approach our civil authorities and to stand up for our beliefs because they threaten our comfortable living conditions. We need a wake-up call lest we lose our souls in the process. So let us learn from these myrrh-bearing women and from Joseph of Arimathea. Let us care for the body of Jesus Christ and his church. He is the bridegroom. We are the bride. Let us pray for courage in the face of the enemy and not to be put to that test of martyrdom. That's why we say in the Lord's Prayer, and lead us not into temptation. What we're saying there is put us not to the test. Let us not turn our faces if we are threatened by our enemies. Let our government hear the words of the angel who said to the myrrh-bearing women, "Myrrh is fitting for the dead, but Christ has shown himself a stranger to corruption. The Lord is risen, bestowing great mercy upon the world." And may the world hear that Christ is risen, Christos voskres, Christos anesti.
Let us all say with our whole soul and with all our mind, let us say, O Lord, almighty God of our fathers, we pray to you, hear us and have mercy. Patriarch Bartholomew, the Archbishop of Constantinople, and for our God-loving Bishop Gregory, for our spiritual fathers and all other clergy, and for all our brethren in Christ, for their welfare, peace, health, salvation, and for the remission of their sins, and that the Lord our God may prompt and help them in all things. In this holy and venerable church, for those who labor in its service, for those who sing, and for all the people here present who await your great and abundant mercy, for those who have shown us kindness, and for all Orthodox Christians. Son, and to the Holy Spirit, always, now, and ever, and forever. Amen. mystically represent the cherubim and are seen to the life-giving Trinity, the thrice holy Him. Let us now lay aside all earthly cares. Of the Church, the honorable government of this country and its armed forces, the blessed and ever-remembered founders and benefactors of this holy Church, for the servants of God, those who are celebrating their birthdays this week, John Barley, Cassidy Solomon, Barry Gilchrist, and Gary Ernest, may the Lord God remember in His kingdom those who are joining us via the internet for their health and God's blessings. For the servants of God, Andrew Kenya, Christopher Nash, Michael Pish, Brad Lewis, Barry Himes and Jacqueline McCann, Elsie Deleba, Mary Gall, and Anna and Paul Schusbar, the priest Thomas Hopko on this the 40th day of his falling asleep, the newly departed servants of God, Matushka Dorothy Timko, Mary Bukovecki and Presbytera, Mary Constantina Vaporis, for their blessed repose, and all you Orthodox Christians, always, now, and ever, and forever. The doors in wisdom.
stand aright, let us stand with fear, let us be attentive, so that we may offer the holy sacrifice in peace. Spirit be with all of you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up our
seraphim, six-winged and many-eyed, who soar aloft on their wings, and who sing, cry out, and proclaim the triumphant hymn, saying,
for the confidence.
especially for our ever holy, ever pure, ever blessed and glorious Lady, the birth giver of God and ever Virgin Mary.
Protect us, O God, by your grace. For a day that in all things will be perfect, holy, peaceful, and without sin, let us beseech the Lord. An angel of peace, a faithful guide, a guardian of our souls and bodies, let us beseech the Lord. Sins and transgressions, let us beseech the Lord. For all that is good and profitable to our souls and for the peace of the world, let us beseech the Lord. That we pass the remainder of our life in peace and repentance, let us beseech the Lord. And for a good account of the fearful judgment seat of Christ, let us beseech the Lord. Having asked for the unity unity of faith in the communion of the Holy Spirit, let us commend ourselves and one another and our whole life to Christ our God.
And make us worthy, O Lord, with full confidence and without condemnation, to dare to call upon you, God, our Heavenly Father, and to say to you,
distribute equally these gifts in a manner beneficial to each according to their need. Sail with those upon the seas, journey with those who travel by land and air. Cure the sick, O healer of our souls and bodies. To the grace, bounties, and love towards mankind of your only begotten Son, with whom you are blessed, together with your all holy, gracious, and life-giving Spirit, now and ever and forever. Your spotless body and your precious blood, and through us to all your people. O God, be merciful to me, a sinner. O God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Theos elasme martelon, eleison me.
Let the partaking of your holy ministry
priest come forth. Please come forth again.
Is risen from the dead,
trampling down death by death, and
to
thank you. receive the divine, holy, most pure, immortal, heavenly, life-creating, awesome mysteries of Christ. Arise, let's both give thanks to the Lord. Protect us, O God, by your grace. Having us at this day, we'll be perfectly holy, peace without sin. Let us commend ourselves and one another and our whole life to Christ our God.
For you are our sanctification, and to you we give glory. To the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever, and forever.
Amen.
Let us depart in peace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
O Lord, blessing those who bless you, and sanctifying those who put their trust in you, save your people and bless your inheritance. Preserve the fullness of your church. Sanctify those who love the beauty of your house. Glorify them by your divine might, and forsake us not to put our hope in you. Grant peace to your world, to your churches, to your priests, to the honorable government of our country, to its armed forces, and to all your people. For every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from you, the Father of lights. To you we give glory and thanksgiving and worship, to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, always, now, and ever, and forever. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Christos Voskres, Christ is risen, Christos Anesti. Birthday greetings are extended today to John Barley. Happy birthday, John, this week. To Cassidy Solomon, to Barry Gilchrist, and to Gary Ernest. ACRY is collecting patron and boosters in the church auditorium after Divine Liturgy this morning. We had a three-week bulletin. This is the third week of the three-week bulletin, so please, if you need to see anything, check the bulletin. We will baptize. We have a baptism this Saturday. Jeris Noah Zrigrat, this coming Saturday morning at 11 a.m. All summer camp registration will be online this year. I'm going to say that again. All summer camp registration will be online this year. Health forms will be needed to be completed by June 15th deadline. I will meet with the parents of those who are going to camp as soon as I get the information, and we'll have a quick meeting after liturgy so that you know exactly what to do for your online registration. Don't worry about it now. We'll let you know what to do. I am honored to inform you that our own Miss Helen Spanovich has been chosen as the Arts and Letters recipient of the 2015 YWCA Tribute to Women Award. I'm sure you may have seen her photograph in the newspaper this morning. A banquet in her honor will be held at the Pascagoula Conference Center. Donation and ticket forms can be found in the church auditorium if you would like to attend. Please place your name along with Christ the Savior Cathedral on the form when you send the form in, and so that they will seat us all together in the same location. Tickets are $75 per person. But in conjunction with that honor and her retirement as our cathedral choir director, we will have a testimonial dinner here at Christ the Savior Educational Center on Tuesday, May 26th. Details are forthcoming in the bulletin, and the price is not set yet, but it will be far less than a $75 ticket at the Pascagoula Theater, I assure you that. We are having a food drive for the Johnstown Food Bank. Please place your non-perishable food items in the blue bucket in the church vestibule. If you would like to give a $5 monetary donation instead, that will buy $25 worth of food in the Pittsburgh area at the markets there. Deepest sympathies are extended to Subdeacon Michael Vaporis, whose mother, Presbytera Mary Constantina Vaporis, fell asleep in the Lord last Sunday, and to the family of Mary Bukovecki, who fell asleep in the Lord this past Friday. She will be buried from our church Monday morning, Panahita, this afternoon at Moscow Funeral Home at 3 p.m. I know there's a lot of announcements today, I know. Panahita for Christopher Nash today, for Michael Pish, for Brad Lewis on the 9th anniversary of his falling asleep, for Barry Himes and Jacqueline McCann on the 40th day of their falling asleep, for Elsie DeLeba, Mary Gall, Anna and Paul Schusbar, the priest Thomas Hopko on this the 40th day of his falling asleep, to Matushka Dorothy Timko, newly departed, and Presbytera Mary Constantina Vaporis, also newly departed this morning. Good to see all of you here this morning, and it was a beautiful day today to see the youngest of all the altar boys coming in that little candle. Brings tears to our eyes, it does. It's a beautiful thing. So good to see all of you here today. May the blessing of the Lord be upon you through his grace and love for mankind, always, now, and ever, and forever. Christ, our true God, risen from the dead, trampling down death by death, and to those in the tombs bestowing life, through the prayers of his most pure mother, through the prayers of a holy father among the saints, John Chrysostom, Archbishop of Constantinople, and through the prayers of Nicodemus, Joseph of Arimathea, and the myrrh-bearing women whom we remember this third Sunday of Pascha, and through the prayers of all the saints, have mercy on us and save us, for he is gracious and he loves mankind. Christos Voskres, Christ is risen, Christos Anesti.
Christ is risen from the dead, trampling down death by death, and to those in the tombs, bestowing life.
Amen.
by death, and to those in the tombs bestowing life.
Lord, save this man,
thank you.
as the 40th day of their falling asleep, Elsie Deleva, Mary Gall, Anna and Paul Schusbaum, the priest Thomas Hopko, and this the 40th day of his falling asleep, Patricia, Dorothy Kimber, newly departed, and the newly departed Tess Patera, Mary Constantine of Boris, who have fallen asleep, and make their memory eternal. Christos was come forward for some bread. Grace is risen from the dead, trampling down death by death of the wounds of the
human
life. Christos is risen from the dead, trampling down death by death.